market history. Built in 1961 as a passenger liner to link Britain and Australia and cater for those assisted passage migrants, she saw action 21 years later in the Falklands War. She hit the headlines again 3 years ago when passengers on several sailings went down with a stomach bug, but she has a clean bill of health now. The Canberra always sails from her home port of Southampton, and that's where our old friends Shaw and Jane Taylor joined the ship. The 13-night cruise took them first to Gibraltar, on to Toulon, Livorno for Florence and Pisa, then to San Remo and the Italian island of Elba, before returning via the Spanish port of Vigo to Southampton. We catch up with the Taylors on board ship.
And this is the navigator. The time is 12 o'clock noon.
The ritual of a sunshine cruise weaves its magic spell.
And a very good afternoon to you, ladies and gentlemen.
So this is what cruising is all about, being transported to interesting parts of the world and never having to change hotels. But Canberra has been in the cruising game for quite a while, and yet she still is well booked. So what are the old girl's secrets? Well, that is what Jane and I have come aboard to find out. Any clues so far, Jane?
Well, one of them is friendliness. And I'll tell you something else. Most of the people I've talked to so far have been on Canberra before, and some of them many times.
Well, if they keep coming back, it speaks for itself, doesn't it?
The Canberra is a very British institution. At 45,000 tons and 13 stories high, she is also one of the larger liners afloat. She carries 1,600 passengers when full. At 22 knots, it takes a couple of days to reach the sunshine of the Mediterranean. The Canberra has the character of what old sea hands like to call a real ship, a traditional style liner, rather than the more bland hotel atmosphere of a modern cruise ship.
What they all have in common, though, are the facilities of a small floating town, a kind of high sea shopping street, with, among other things, a beauty salon, a bank, and a boutique. Mr. Cartier.
Up above, there's a wide range of sporting activities. Tuition is available on some cruises. An old favourite, the passenger versus crew cricket match. The Canberra is Britain in search of fun abroad. The serious business, the captain at work.
Hello there, welcome to you. Pleased to have you aboard.
Thank you.
Hi there, how are you?
The social side, the captain's cocktail party. A chance to meet the officers and fellow passengers. Cruising no longer means starchy formality, though most passengers like to dress up. The Canberra has had a complete facelift in the past 5 years. Though now a one-class ship, some cabins are still without private bathrooms. Cabins vary in size and style, and the standard fixes the price of your cruise. Ours is a middle range inside one and has a shower and loo. In turn, your cabin dictates in which restaurant you eat. The larger Atlantic restaurant is rather more casual than the smaller Pacific one, although whichever you choose, there are formal evenings like the black and white night. Both restaurants have two sittings and meals are identical. Seven-course dinners, for instance, with plenty of choice.
Food is wholesome British fare, with many familiar dishes and the occasional unusual speciality. In short, nothing too exotic. If you don't want to be tied down to strict mealtimes, there's a daily flexible breakfast and lunch buffet taken in the island room.
There's always plenty of choice, either hot or cold dishes. Hot dishes today, fish pie or vegetable curry, or there's a selection of meats together with salad and a dessert. What are you having, Jane?
I've got the curry and watermelon. And the good thing about eating up here is that it doesn't cost extra. Like all food on board, it's included in the cost of the cruise.
Good. Well, let's tuck in.
Cruise ships pride themselves on pampering the palate. During this fortnight, we'll munch our way through 11 tons of meat, 4.5 tons of fish, 63,000 eggs, 97,000 loaves and rolls, and a mere 2,500 litres of ice cream. Gibraltar. One of the six ports of call, a British stronghold just 3 miles long and 1,400 feet high.
I would like to be master of that ship. In fact, I wouldn't mind being master of any of those at once.
Legend has it that British occupation of the rock will end when its 66 most notorious inhabitants die out.
Ooby-doo, I want to be like you.
Hop-dee-hooby-doo-bop.
I want to walk like you.
Chip-talk
like you.
Chip-choo.
Weeby-dee-bee-doo. You see, it's true.
Shoo-bee-dee-doo.
An ape like me.
Scooby-dooby-dooby.
Can't learn to be human too.
There's the airstrip and what looks like the cathedral there, can you see it?
Well, let's find out where we are first.
Well,
the cathedral's right here.
Yes.
So where's the
cathedral is number 14.
Where's number 14?
So it's...
With P&O's helpful port guides, there's no real need to take an organised excursion in a place this small. Frankly, Gibraltar is not much to write home about. Shopping is a bit cheaper than back in Britain, though, and pounds and pence are legal tender. Well, they would be, wouldn't they?
The Crow's Nest. A quiet drink before the evening gets underway.
Production numbers from well-known musicals, gala balls or disco hopping, a classical recital or the midnight cabaret. Entertainment is professional and polished, with a staff of 87 ensuring that somewhere there will be something for most tastes. And that's not just an idle brochure claim. But we found there's no pressure to join in. On the other hand, it's easy to meet other people. About a quarter of the passengers on most cruises are single folk. You can socialise over mid-morning coffee or simply find ways of amusing yourself. And although people, by and large, are gregarious, you can always find a quiet spot.
The Canberra is a little bit of Britain abroad. Bars, drinks, and cheerful attentive service are high on most holiday lists. A gin and tonic cost us 82 pence last summer, a scotch 70 pence, and a pint of lager 85 pence. Cheaper than back at home, and the measures are a bit larger.
The key to all the activities on board is contained in this little news sheet, Canberra Today, which comes under your cabin door every day and tells you all the things you can get up to. Tells you what sort of dress to wear for dinner, tells you what activities there are. Now, we're in port today, we're not going ashore, so let's see what we can do. Jane, what have we got?
Well, this morning you've got indoor games at 10:30. You've got
5 and 6:56. All the ones gentlemen knows lovely, legs 11.
Children, too, have their own social programme, in port and at sea. For the 2 to 11-year-olds, the Junior Club lets parents off the hook for a while. It's open daily with an experienced staff well-versed in keeping young ones occupied. Those in the know come prepared for the fancy dress. Others rely on a mix of last-minute imagination and panic. Teenagers also have their own club. During the school holidays, the Canberra is more a family ship than normal, when the average passenger age is older. Cruising makes for easy travelling. You can see several countries without the constant hassles of packing and unpacking. The ship's free tender ferries you ashore at Elba. If you took an excursion at each port of call, you could pay £150 or so a person. And we've found that when you exchange money into a foreign currency, you get a far better rate ashore than on board ship. Elba rates high on scenery, but low on history. Napoleon came this way, but wasn't banished here. Contrary to popular belief, it was remote as St. Helena. And world events, as well as mass tourism, have passed it by. You can polish off the whole island on a leisurely one-day coach tour. The half-day trip stops at the small resort of Marciana Marina for a spot of local wine tasting.
Aleatico is the red, Moscato the white, both sweet.
Beautiful.
personal record of life afloat. During days at sea, you'll find plenty of opportunity to brush up an old skill or try something entirely new.
With some 30 things to do a day, the problem is likely to be one of choice. Cruising doesn't have to be an exercise in indulgence. You can tone up both mind and muscle and lose money as well as weight. Race nights.
Get set and go!
The tote is certainly kept busy. But don't forget the final extra, tipping. Around £30 to £35 should cover gratuities to cabin steward, waiters and any other special services.
So this is almost it. Vigo disappearing over the horizon and we're on the last leg of the journey. Across the Bay of Biscay, up the channel and then into Southampton.
You know, one of the things I really like is leaving from Southampton and then being taken back.
I know. None of that hassle of airports and delays. And we've been well looked after. You haven't been overworked, have you?
I've been to Laundrette once.
But how long can it go on? 30 years Canberra has been cruising successfully. Are her days finished? Well, I can tell you this. There are going to be some sad faces amongst the regulars when eventually she has to go, but I somehow feel it's not going to be for quite a few years yet.
Canberra is operating a number of Mediterranean cruises this year, but no two are quite the same. There's one in September that costs from £950 to £3,890 for 14 nights. Depending on which cabin you're in, there are substantial reductions for children. The cabin we showed cost £2,045 on this cruise. The price includes all meals and entertainment. The only extras are excursions, drinks, and tips.